All right. Well, I know I'm the last segment tonight, so one of you guys is going first. Probably Josh, a
Yep.
66.6% chance. So,
Yes.
yep.
Yes. Now we're covering Mary J. Blige, her debut album, What's the 411? In the opening montage, you heard Real Love, and now you're going to hear Love No Limit. To the joy I'll bring, I want to give you. Okay, Matt, what's the stats on this one?
So, What's the 411 by Mary J. Blige comes in at number 1,729 on the best ever albums in the 1990s, number 170 in 1992, number 10,166 of all time. It's Mary J. Blige's second highest rated album on best ever albums behind 1994's My Life, which I assume we are going to cover that. And Mary, this did make Rolling Stone's list. I forgot the number. I got it somewhere around here. I'll tell you in a second. But Mary J. Blige is ranked number 1,929 of overall artist rankings on Best Ever Albums.
Yes, the queen of hip hop soul has entered the music universe now with this album. This album was released July 28th, 1992. Mary J. Blige was born in the Bronx in 1971. Mary J. Blige is her real name; it's not a stage name. The J stands for Jane, and she moved to Georgia in her early childhood, and then moved back to Yonkers in New York later on. She was born in 1971. She has 15 studio albums, with the most recent being in 2022. This is her debut album. She is classified as hip hop or R&B or hip hop R&B, which is, I guess, a subgenre of both. She was influenced by, all the famous women that you can probably think of: Aretha Franklin, Minnie Riperton, Whitney Houston, Sade, Anita Baker, Roberta Flack. We've covered almost all of those artists. Similar artists: Mariah Carey, En Vogue, TLC, Aaliyah, Toni Braxton, Monica, and followed by people like Alicia Keys, Brandy, Destiny's Child, Erykah Badu, Rihanna. Her highest charting single is Family Affair from the 2001. It reached number one for 6 weeks, and she's had two number one albums: Share My World, which reached number one in 1997, and The Breakthrough in 2006. Some fun facts about her: she was discovered at age 17 after recording a cover of Anita Baker's Caught Up in the Rapture at a recording booth at a mall in White Plains, New York. So it's funny you said that earlier, John, about recording in a mall. Her mother's boyfriend passed the tape on to an A&R guy at Uptown Records, which then the president of that label heard, and she was signed in 1989 as a backup singer. This album was produced by Sean Combs, so he also knows Puff Diddy and whatever name, Puff Daddy and whatever other name he's going by at this point. He's probably come back around at this point, name wise. And Blige was previously a 411 operator, hence the name of the album. She was the and for those who don't know, 411 was information, the information number on touchtone phone. You could call to get information about if you need the business or
It
something
was
like that.
Google. It was how you Googled back then.
She was Google. Mary J. Blige was Google before Google.
Exactly. Exactly.
She is the most successful female R&B artist of 1992, with this album. It was very popular. She released a remix version of this album in December of 1993, which extended the life of her of the album and her popularity into 94 while she was recording another album. And most recently, she has a Christmas album called A Merry Christmas, MARY, which I find hilarious. And she her most recent album is 2022's Good Morning Gorgeous, and last year she performed at the Super Bowl halftime show with Eminem and Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg and everybody else that was in that performance. So she's still active, doing well, and well, doing well as far as I know. And so her debut album. Let's start with John. What did you think of What's the 411?
Yeah, this I remember this. I keep saying like this week I remember, so I'm gonna try to get out of that habit. But The reason is because I can remember vividly when this dropped out because Real Love was such a big hit off this album. And we had a drill team at my junior high that was very good. Are you guys familiar with what a drill team is?
Yeah, I am.
Yep. Okay. Look at Matt. Any
I
idea?
think
Make
I
it up to.
refresh my memory again.
It's like a dance team, but sort of with a little bit more, I guess, like hip hop edge to it, I would
Okay.
say, like precision movement, stuff like
Okay.
that. So, and our drill team did Real Love, and it was right when Real Love came out, and it was just this, it was super well received, and it was a really memorable moment because it was there was an energy to it, and you can immediately the thing with Mary J. Blige, if you it starts and ends with Mary J. Blige at that one Grammy performance when she does No More Drama. Have you guys, speaking of, if you haven't seen that, anybody listening to this, just Google Grammys. I think it's 2002, No More Drama, Mary J. Blige, and she just by the end, it's just you cannot be anymore. It's one of my dad's favorite performances on earth. Like he'll occasionally just watch it a couple times a
Wow.
year just because he loves it so much. It's just like
I
he's like,
think I
that's the
did see it. I have
purest.
to, it's been years though, so
He's
like
just
I
kind of
have
like, that's
to.
the purest distillation of like feeling it like at a level
Yeah.
that's above consciousness, kind of like that's. And so he kind
You're
of
like
like
in the
uses it
zone.
as the bar. Oh, just
Yeah.
like you're just an out-of-body experience, kind of.
Yeah.
But I love Mary J. Blige's voice. It's this like dark, sexy in its own way, but with a deep authority to it. It's a lived-in voice, even here when she's young, right? There's an immediate authority to her voice that's vulnerable but also strong, sometimes within the same song. It's a low register. She's a great singer, but she's not a traditional classic singer. And part of and even with it, there's parts of it can sound ragged at times, but the raggedness is part of what makes her such a great singer because the emotion coming through. With that being said, being familiar with her catalog, she's going to make a lot better albums than this one. I felt that this album was a little long. It was a little undistinguished as a full album. The top tracks were extremely strong, but when I just don't know if the material quite yet was where it needed to be to extend out to a full long play at this point. And so that's going to kind of put this album, I would say, in the middle for me because it doesn't have the staying power, I think, that her future stuff has. It's fascinating as a first album because you know where Mary J. Blige is going, and there's elements, especially in Real Love, of what that brand is going to be. But there also is still a little bit of, I love you, you love me type of songs at this. And when I think of Mary J. Blige, I think of like more nuanced love songs a little bit, like the parts of love that aren't easy or the parts of love that cut deep. But she here is doing a lot more songs of like, this is the beauty of love, and just songs that feel like they were written, but they weren't written for her. And I think maybe just over time, she got a lot more material that was written lyrically, kind of for her and her persona
Right.
a little bit. And it's a
Yeah.
little bit of a mishmash persona here. I also think Mary J. Blige is one of those singers that she crossed over to the mainstream, but also was a definitively what I guess back then you would call an urban act, right? Where they're pretty big in the mainstream world, but they're huge, in black culture and urban culture. And Mary J. Blige somehow went from being that in the 90s, I think, and then in like the 2000s, she went into like full-on culture, right? In a way that somebody like Jodeci, right? Or I bring them up, which is interesting because she dated Casey Haley for a long time, and or R. Kelly even, right? Like people that were massive, but then people in mainstream culture didn't process them as big as maybe urban culture did, right? And so Mary J. Blige sort of was there, and so for a long time, I was listening to Mary J. Blige, but then a lot of people who you'd think would be listening to her were not listening to her. So like for me, she was a pop star, but I think in other worlds she was an R&B star, right? Like, and not a pop star. And so that's always an interesting thing when you're meeting somebody from a place that maybe other people aren't. But I think my takeaway for this one is it's a little bit of a flawed album because the drawing card is Mary J. Blige's charisma, but the material is not all of it. Like, some of it is, but the most of it is not quite up to the standard of you know, what she's going to command later or what will bring the best out of her. So,
yeah. All right, Matt, what about you?
So before I do my take, this did make Rolling Stone's list, number 271 of all time for Rolling Stone. Yeah. So, wow, John, I think I'm higher on this album than you are. I think this is like the first like real R&B album that I've heard in a while that I don't know if we count. Is Janet Jackson's Rhythm Nation, is that R&B? Does that fall in that category?
It's like, it's as much pop as it is R&B.
Yeah. I mean, this seems to be more like the R&B, like some of the stuff that we've done, like the Johnny Gill, the, you know, Bobby Brown, you know, that type of thing. I don't know. I really like this. I agree. I think her voice is very strong. And I think that I just liked the production of it. I didn't know it was Puff Daddy, but it just fits really well. It sounds, I don't think this sounds terribly dated or anything like that. I think that there's like, but it also doesn't sound modern. It's got this weird, I don't know. There's like this in-between nature of the production for me, but, I generally really like the beats in particular, for some of these songs that just gave it a little extra heft. And I liked kind of the ballads, you know, like Slow Down was like this, you know, this nasty sex song, or not nasty, but she's just, you know,
that's
she's
kind of a sex, sweet like, sex song. Actually.
It is a very, yeah. It is. A, yeah, you're right. It's a sweet sex, but it's like, it's getting very descriptive and it, but, and it's usually not the type of song that like, I'm like, oh man,
now,
this is my
did
thing.
Did you read it?
But
as
like, there's something about the way that,
was it premature ejaculation or over exuberance in terms of speed? How did you read that song? Cause I wasn't quite sure. Yeah.
I would say the latter.
The latter too. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. But even a song like that, I was like, damn, for some reason, there was something I just melodically, like the way it was produced, the way she sounds, it sounded great. So, I mean, if this is kind of like, if she's better, I mean, I know her hits, probably, I know, obviously I knew, Real Love. I do remember, you know, a number of her other, you know, hits and things like that. But I think it's going to be interesting for me
drama,
to hear the deep.
Not,
yeah, no more
cry.
Drama. What was the one that you said won the award or won? It was a duet.
Well,
that
no
she
more
did
drama
with
is what she was singing. But
no, that was the
big ones. Oh.
Yeah, okay. But there was another one that she hit number one at or something. Josh was saying.
Well, there's like Not Gonna Cry was a big song.
Family Affair.
That's it. That was with Gwen Stefani.
I Can
right?
Love You.
Yeah.
No, that's Eve.
Oh, that's Eve. Wait,
let me blow your minds.
Right, that's that one. Okay, anyway, so I'm getting confused. Anyway, my point is, I like the deeper cuts, okay? Like, the deeper cuts were surprisingly, like, I didn't get bored with them. And I think I like a female R&B singer better than a male R&B singer. Mm-hmm. And I noticed when, because she's got basically, who she got? Casey from Casey and JoJo, like,
yes.
on one of these songs. Yeah. And I like that song, but that was one of my least favorite songs on the album. Because I'm like, I don't know. I like Mary J's voice, and I like it on here. So I'm thumbs up on this. This was a nice surprise for me.
Yeah, I'm more in the John camp, I think, on this album. I know Mary J. Blige for a long time, probably knew her more in like the late 90s, early 2000s, when she would with those albums and her kind of guest spots on other songs. And you know, they always did the kind of rap R&B crossovers with different artists. And I think this album is rated highly in part because it's kind of historically important in a lot of ways. Like, a lot of, there wasn't a lot of like rap R&B crossing over or the fusion of the two together, especially with female artists at that time. And I think it, like, later on, and it kind of influenced the decade. And so I think that's why it's maybe on the Rolling Stone list. I felt this was kind of a weak album, and I think it's kind of, it's not her fault. I think it's like, it feels like a debut album to me, and I feel like she gets much better and more of her identity comes through, or, you know, like John said, writing songs written for her, or if she's writing, that becomes stronger as well. And I think everything just gets refined and honed and improved later on. And, and I think this doesn't match what comes later ultimately. In my mind, I disagree with you, Matt. I did not like the production on this album. I also found kind of the structure of the album weird. I thought the Leave a Message intro was horrible in like a weird way to start the album. And especially when you have a track later that's called Intro Talk with Busta Rhymes, like, why not make that the first track if you're introducing her to the world? And And so things like that were weird, and I feel like the songs go on too long. It's that classic like R&B trap where it's just like after like the 3 minute mark, it's just repetition
So
of
funny.
drawing out the same song over and over, or just kind of capitalizing on her voice and playing that out. And that happens over and over on this album. Also, I just feel like it's kind of like it seems very like artificial, like with Real Love, like the drum sound that they're using. I feel like there's gotta, it's almost like they used a little keyboard or something and just put it right next to a
Put it on
microphone.
drum
It's
mode.
like, yeah, it's like really, really simplistic and skeletal in a lot of ways on this album. But I think the talent is there, and what kind of the inkling of what's to come is there as well. And I just feel like there's better things. So I'm gonna give this like squarely a kind of thumbs in the middle to
Well,
down.
I'm excited to hear what else she's got, 'cause I don't know, like, and I
Well,
can't
her
argue
other
with a
albums in
lot
the
of.
90s are all better.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Like,
well,
and
then I'm excited.
we're gonna cover, I know for a fact we cover Share My World. I don't know if we cover My Life, which is the next one, but My Life's got some big hits off of it. It's got like I'm Going Down, which
We
was a
do
big
cover My
hit.
Life.
Okay,
Yes.
yeah, so
Yeah,
there's
that's her highest rated on best ever
My
albums.
Life.
Yeah.
Yeah, it doesn't surprise me. And
We have
the
some
next couple,
singles that
Share
we're
My
covering too.
World has multiple singles. She did that album Mary, which wasn't as well received. And then, of course, she did that No More Drama album that has like three massive hits on it and is like
Well,
basically exploded her. So,
I
yeah.
don't want to say no. It was only blowing my mind in the sense that like I listened through it like once or twice and I was like, I think I like this. Like I didn't love it, but I was like, wow, this is very, to me, it was very solid and it was, and I don't disagree with what you're saying, Josh, about, you know, they, 'cause some of these songs do go on long. There is a lot of repetition, but it's just the weirdest thing. I never was like, okay, move on. Like I, whatever groove they were in or part that they were doing, I liked enough that I was okay with them extending it for an extra, you know, minute and a
She
half or whatever it was.
might have the riz for you, man. That's
She
kind of what
might. She
R&B,
might.
that's kind of, I mean, this is how I keep explaining it to you, Matt. Like, some of R&B is like what, you know, floats your
Yeah.
boat, so to speak. It isn't so much technical. It's just like, I like that person's,
Yes.
the cut
The
of that
cut of her
person's
jib.
jib. Yes. So, yeah, I wanted to go with a more modern style with the oldest anachronistic thing I could say. So, but yeah, I mean, but there you go, Matt. That's your first example of, yeah, I like this because I like what
Yeah.
that person sounds like. And I found myself, yeah. So
I did.
there you go. R&B's coming to you,
It
Matt.
is.
Mm-hmm.
I
I
can
can
be
be
her duet
convinced.
with Method Man on "You're All I Need to Get By."
Oh,
That's a great
yeah.
track.
That's
That's gonna
on
be
no
later on.
albums either. That was a single only. I think it's on Tickle.